We'll be starting shortly. I think people are joining. So just wait for a few minutes for everyone to join. Yes, good afternoon. I am Ruchi Kumar from Center for Excellence in Teacher Education, Tata Institute of Social Sciences, Mumbai. And we have been doing this School Synergy workshop series since 2020. And the objective of this workshop series is to create a platform where the ideas related to practice can be shared. Teachers can discuss ideas that can be implemented in practice, their experience, and ideas from both sides basically can be discussed and elaborated further. So today we have with us Roshan Sahi, who has been working as art consultant for several years, has collaborated with several organizations, both nationally as well as internationally, and has also created a handbook on art education with Jain Sahi itself. And he's going to focus on ideas related to childhood, play, and rhythm. And I think it is going to be a very interesting session. And I'm looking forward to participating. He shared a list that we must be having with us. So things like a thing or an object and an instrument that can produce a sound, a large sheet of old newspaper or any newspaper, or even cardboard boxes would be okay. And some sort of colors like watercolor or with brush or chalk or oil pastel. Even oil pastels will be okay. And pencil and paper to jot down some notes. So if you have not collected these things, just take a minute and quickly get these things ready. We may be using it during the session. I'll repeat, an instrument that can produce a sound, anything also, it can be a katori chamach also if you want, a sheet of old newspaper, colors, poster colors or chalk or oil pastels, and pencil and paper to jot down notes. So over to you, Roshan. Looking forward to your session.
Super.
Yeah.
Okay, great. Yes, thank you very much, Dr. Ruchi. Yes. I'm super glad that this platform is here so that we can all share our ideas. So it's really, it is about sharing. It's not obviously about telling, but it's about also learning. And that learning, I think, is something that we all really share. Yeah. So yeah, I'm glad to be here as a part of that that community. So what I'd really like to start with is that we can kind of explore an instrument. So the instrument, to give you a clue, could be yourself. Yeah, so you could also be an instrument. But otherwise, definitely, I've got a flute, which I love playing. You could also have a drum. You could have a bowl, something that kind of produces a sound. Yeah. What we'll really do is that we'll spend a few moments gathering our kind of thoughts, gathering our senses, and playing with the sound. Yeah, so I'd really like you to explore the idea of playing with the sound. Okay, So we'll give this the first, we'll give it a 2 minute, you know, sort of time for each one of us to play with the sound. And then I request you to unmute yourself and continue playing with the sound. Yeah, so then we'll have another 2 minutes where each one of you are request to unmute yourself and share the sound that you are playing with. Yeah, and then we'll see how that kind of that can develop. Okay, make sense? Yeah. So first 2 minutes, just gather any sound. A pencil is a good sound maker. You can actually produce sounds. It's quite a broad spectrum that you can actually choose from. Okay, so 2 minutes. Let's give this a skip. Thank you. Unmute yourself, and we can continue to play with the sounds, so that we can basically have a soundscape. Fantastic. That's lovely.
Hey, it was really fun playing with the sounds.
Yeah. So please feel free to unmute yourself and comment as we sort of go along. Don't feel shy. It is about sharing and it is about dialogue. So we're really kind of, we're playing with the game. Yeah, we're playing with the sounds. We're playing with the ideas. Nice. Is that a sound which is coming from a bird? That's a lovely sound. I heard that. Cool. Okay, so now let's continue with the sound element, with the sound idea. And what I'd like you to do is actually to take your body as an instrument, which is not only producing sounds, but it is actually creating forms, yeah? So what I'd really like you to do is to recall the sounds that you have made. You can add to that. You can actually go, wah, la, 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 la. Yeah, so you can actually produce sounds with your mouth, or you can go like this, yeah? You can actually make sounds as you sort of go along. And I would really like you to actually stand up. Yeah? So we are not sitting down. So I'd really like you to actually see yourselves as a moving body. And yeah, obviously not stuck to your seats. Yeah.
Okay, if you feel comfortable, you can put on your videos. Yeah. If you feel comfortable, you can put on your videos. The session is being recorded. If you feel comfortable, you can put it on. And it would be really nice to see how you are doing. We are also going to participate. Yeah. Yes. Chitra?
Okay. So here we are. So we can just feel, you can close your eyes. Sometimes it helps if you were to close your eyes. Or you can just...
You have to shed your inhibitions.
Everywhere. Yeah.
Yeah.
So just move your body. Think about the sound. Remember, recall the sound. So if you can actually think, what was the sound that you actually tried to produce? And can you sort of connect to that sound? Can you actually make, can you make a body shape from that sound? Yeah, can you actually think what was going on in that sound? Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, and just, it's always nice to bend your knees.
Can you all, can some of you try to put on their videos? You feel comfortable?
Yeah.
Should be nice for you to join. Thank you, Yatin. Would you like to also participate in the activity?
Nice. Cool. Okay. So now we have, I just want to ask, do you have some material, even if you do not have colors, even if you don't have brushes, do you have actually a pencil or, so we won't immediately need that, but I'd like you to have something that you can actually create a mark with. Okay. And I've suggested this newspaper. So you can actually very well make a mark on a piece of newspaper. A newspaper is a good material to make a mark on. If you're really in a hurry, most welcome to find any, you know, like a scrap piece of paper, anything that you find close by. Okay, so don't feel inhibited by not having the right kind of material. Yeah, just something that you can, I have suggested sometimes you can also write in your hand. Yeah, your hand is a very good surface for making a mark. Yeah, so that's also very beautiful. In fact, the mehendi patterns that you see are beautiful patterns that you see on the body. Yeah, so you can actually think about the body also as a surface to express your thoughts. Yeah. Okay. So what I'm going to ask you to do is actually to, I'm going to use a little bit of, I've got some color and I've got a little bit of like a brush. Okay. And I'll spend a little bit of time recalling back the movements that I've made with my body with my brush in my hand. And seeing what are the shapes that are actually coming out of those movements that I can also transfer onto a surface. Yeah. So this is an activity which you call as, you could say, drawing in air. Yeah. So you start with drawing in air. You can actually go like that. You can go like this. I'm suggesting you can even take the brush. And if you can see me, you can actually take the brush and put it under your leg and take it the other side. Yeah. So you don't have to feel restricted that your brush is on the right side. Okay. So remember that the brush is something that can actually move. Yeah, it can go right round, it can come from back, and it can come again here. Yeah. So the brush is not something which is just stuck to this hand. Yeah. So that's the feeling. Great.
I think it is about shedding your inhibition also, like being able to do all this on camera and not feel inhibited. Yeah.
So thank you for that, Dr. Rishi. Yes. So great. So what I also suggest for you to kind of feel like, you know, to build some kind of like a feeling of what you're doing, just use your brush with water. So nobody knows quite what you're doing, but you kind of get to know that you're actually doing something with a brush or with a pencil. You can even use a pencil, yeah, on a surface. So you don't actually have to make a mark yet. Typically, we can sort of like almost recall that before you even start writing, you're sort of thinking along and you're kind of almost pretending that you're kind of doing a squiggle in the air, yeah? You're thinking, what was that all about? You know, how did that actually, what is that, you know? So you're actually not writing, but you're kind of, you could say, pretending to write, yeah? So let's do a little bit of pretending to do something with a drawing, yeah? And you can do, it's a doodle. So you don't have to actually get to do the drawing yet. It's kind of just getting your hand movements. Okay. Yeah. Okay. So we are also kind of working along with the whole spatial body movement. And we are trying to see how that kind of works on a two-dimensional surface area. Yeah. So how does this movement or that movement become something that can actually be incorporated in this surface area? Cool. So I'm going to start a little bit on. Okay. Now, we're talking about colors also. So you can think of, if you do have colors, you can start with the blue, or you can, you can start with any color, and then you can shift into another color. Yeah. So see that.
Should we now start making the mark?
Yes, I'm opening it up so that you can actually start reflecting on this process and actually seeing how colors are also going to be effective.
Okay.
Yeah, they're also going to change the way in which you're thinking about the forms. One other thing that I did want to say is, if you can go back to the sound that you made, can you actually produce that sound? Like, for example, I was doing the flute. So I could go. Or you could be a drum, you could have actually made a. And how do you actually see a sound, which was essentially the beginning of what we did, which then helped us kind of move into a movement. And now we're actually working towards a mark. I always love listening to music as I'm drawing.
Yeah.
I don't know if we could have that in this session, but
one will have to select a music that resonates with everyone. That is there.
You can have different music also, like working. Great.
Come on, people. I would encourage all of you also to start participating, put on your videos. It's a golden chance to become children, actually.
Become an adult, I would also say.
Yeah,
nice. Okay, so we're going to add a little bit to this. If you remember, I also suggested that you could have your brushes sort of moving between things. Yeah. So if you could actually see that the lines that you are creating are something which is on a surface, but they're also moving between things. Yeah, they're actually, if you can, you could actually go over some of the lines that you want, and you can see how those lines are actually working between other lines. And maybe sometimes they kind of disappear, and then they sometimes reappear. Yeah. So what are those lines that have actually been made, and are they going behind
another line, or are they coming in front of another line? Yeah, what is the kind of relationship between where those lines are in relation to your marking? Yeah, are they on top of things? Are they below things? Do they have a layer? So for those who are working with a monochrome, it's always nice to think about tonality. So you can think of light and dark shades, and how do the light and dark shades play in relation to what we're understanding as a spatial dimension. Yeah, we're looking at it in terms of depth of field. So the light and darkness kind of plays into things that are typically lighter can be seen almost in the distance, and things that are dark can be almost seen up front. So how do you interplay that? How do you work it between those two? So you're looking at tonality. So we're looking at colors, and we're looking at forms, and we're looking at tonality. Yeah? So even in a brushwork, you can actually get beautiful tonalities. Great. Have some of you been able to work with your sound? Great. So I'm going to add to this image, I'm going to start adding another component, which is something to do with how do you feel? Yeah? So I've made something to do with a soundscape. I've made something to do with a bodyscape, if you like. I've made something to do with a movement that I can then transfer onto a piece of paper. So I've made a mark out of that. Yeah. And now I've got something to do with, am I feeling happy? Am I feeling angry about something? Am I feeling melancholic about something? Am I feeling thoughtful about something? Am I reflective about something? Am I curious about something? Am I awestruck about something? Am I surprised about something? Yeah? So that's something that we have in, for example, if you know the Navrasas, yeah, it's a topic about looking at the spectrum of emotions and seeing that maybe we have many emotions happening at all together at the same time. And if we were to recall that we have a feeling about being angry about something, is there something else that is also changing our way of thinking about why maybe we're being angry about something? Is it because we were actually having so much fun that it's all stopped and therefore we are getting angry about something? Yeah, so it's not just about being angry about something. It's about a recall of something where, you know, there was something which was wonderful about whatever it was, and now it seems to have all disappeared. And therefore you're thinking about how unfair things are. Yeah, so could you spend a little bit of time thinking about when you're drawing, what you're drawing, maybe even the colors that you're using? Are you happy about something? Are you curious about something? Are you fed up about something? And what kind of form can that be? If I'm fed up about something, what is that shape? Yeah? Does it have an association? Is it something to do with a, what can we say? Is it something to do with Yeah. Great. Okay. So I'm still working on mine. It's not going to finish too easily, but I'm getting there. I'm feeling that I'm going to start working on it to the point where I will start as we speak. You can also continue to do what you're doing. Yeah. And sometimes in this case, I feel I've come to a point where I need to think a little bit more about what I'm doing. Yeah. So I can give it a moment of just allowing it to be what it is, just seeing what has come about. Okay.
That's good.
Yeah. Okay, I'm going to steal some time and get some water for myself. Just 2 minutes.
Yeah, sure. Okay. So we can also have a water break.
Just 2 minutes, yeah.
So hang on there, we'll be back in 2 minutes.
Hi, Ruchi.
Hi.
Ruchi, can I use this time to ask you a question or two?
Sure. Please go ahead.
I am Namrata. Yeah, he's back. Yeah, let's talk later. Yeah.
Yeah.
I'm listening.
Yeah. No, I think right now we focus on the session at hand. If there is anything related to School Synergy Workshop series, you can message me later, okay? Or send a private message about the question you want to ask. So we are back, Roshan. You want to continue?
Yes. Great. So I'm interested to hear if anybody has any thoughts, any reflections about what, any sharing of an experience that you've just had. In this last 20 minutes, we can say 25 minutes. And what can we build from this? As being facilitators ourselves, what kind of instruction can we take out of this? What kind of a experience can we design out of this? Could you say that there's a kind of a model in this that one can actually build on? And where could we take these ideas? Yeah, or do they have any ideas, or is it something which is like random? Yeah. So yeah. I'd like to hear from you. What are your thoughts?
Abhishek Kumar Mishra, do you want to unmute and share? If anybody wants to share, so whatever activities we did here, what do you make out of it? How we can use it for ourselves, for children? Any ideas that you have got? Chitra?
Hi, this is Manjiri. Yeah.
Go ahead.
Manjiri. I love the idea of painting. I love the idea of painting or drawing while dancing or moving. Because usually painting or drawing happens when one is sitting at one place. And so I love this idea. I don't know what I've done, but the idea of making some shapes on the paper while moving is very, very appealing to me.
Thank you so much. I love that that sense of also joy, yeah, that we all can have when we're doing something. There's a kind of a element of, you know, I feel surprised that, you know, like how did that come about in that particular way? Yeah, so dancing can also allow us to kind of open up the worlds around us in terms of, you know, yeah. So I'm not going to say anything more about that. I'm going to hear more about what other people have felt. Do you feel doubtful about something? Do you feel, okay, so one other thing that I would really like to also kind of bring this, kind of anchor this whole thing in relation to children and childhood. So we are looking at playfulness. We're looking at the concept of what I've suggested as rhythm. Where do we find rhythm? Did we feel that there was any rhythm in what we did? And how do we see this in relation to childhood? How do we understand the child as somebody who is center to what we're actually, the conversations that we're having about? Yeah. So yes, I'm hearing, I'm listening to, I'd really like to hear from you.
This is Manjiri again. May I say something?
Yes, please.
Many times we listen to music while doing other activities.
Yes.
For example, you said you draw while listening to music. Or maybe yeah. I'm cooking something, listening to music. Maybe I'm doing something else, listening to music.
Yeah.
But this is something, I don't know, but we are actually... I don't know how much attention we are paying to the music and how much attention we are paying to the thing that we are doing with your hands.
Yes.
So how is that different from what we have just done?
Yes. Is that a kind of a reflection, or would you like me to say something around that, or how would you... That's the reflection.
Yeah, I would like you to say something about it.
Roshan, there are a few chats also. I don't know if you can
share. I'm happy to hear from, can I, yeah. Can
I can read it if you want. So there is this Namrata Makan from English department. Yeah. And she really liked the idea of free painting with dancing and moving. And she said that when she was doing that, she felt calm and relaxed. And thanks to you. And a few of them wanted to, I think, see your painting again, what you had done on the paper.
That's a secret now. No, I'm looking. So let's focus on the childhoodness of what we are actually like. We are also having a conversation around learning, and mm-hmm. we are also having a conversation around, I'm super happy to share what I've done. What I'm trying to also say is that, you know, what is it that actually we are doing in terms of, so that's me. Yeah. So let's see. We can also share. I'd love this. If you do have some photos that you could actually like share as we're speaking, maybe even that of your what you have actually done, so that, you know, other people can become like a virtual exhibition. Yeah, that's something. Yes, thank you for that.
This is.
Could we get a focus on that? I can't see properly.
Okay, we will have to do a spotlight view.
Yes.
Can you see now? Is it better?
Yes. Thank you so much.
Yeah.
Yes. So this is also.
So I did this on the basis of drums that were.
I love that. Happy. That's beautiful. See how different that is from what I have done, no? Which is, it's interesting. Yeah, because your soundscape is different from, in a way, my soundscape. Yeah, and then we can build on that. We can see how we can actually develop different kinds of soundscapes and what are the kind of relationships that we can build in that. Yeah. So thank you so much for that.
Anybody else would like to share?
Yes, please. So any questions you have around maybe the what you're calling as a kind of a, if this were understood as a kind of an instructional mode, what would be our take on this, you know, and where would we, what are the kind of links that we would see that can actually open up our ways of thinking and understanding about the world around us? Yeah. So we're both looking at it in terms of a formal, you could say an expression, yeah, which is in this case, you know, the medium of a particular kind. So it could be in video, for example, or it could be in music. So how much, the question that I would like to kind of build on, which was the question about music, it may be a good thing for us to also recall that we were really making sounds. So the amount of music was, you know, I think a development of the sound. And then how much of that was actually music in the sense, how much of it was actually a melody that we were able to incorporate, maybe an emotion, for example, or a subject. Yeah. So typically when we're sort of like responding to music, we're also responding to maybe a more complex relationship of sounds. Yeah. And so from something which is playful, something which is, you could say, rhythmic, to something which you could also maybe say as, we haven't really got quite to the point of it being a melody, but we were attempting, we were kind of, you know, maybe just touching the edge of what we could sort of venture into in terms of our emotions. Yeah, and that's something that we can see. Maybe I opened that up as a kind of a window to kind of, you know, build on the sort of maybe the more sort of the sort of initial you could say, you know, almost like the starting of, you know, some kind of process. Yeah, we are looking at it as a process, and how do we build on process, how do we understand process? Okay. So can I have anybody else who's able to kind of respond to this question about this? Have your own thoughts about what we mean by process, what we mean by expression, what we mean by communication, which is non-verbal. So we're also working with elements that are non-verbal. And that's something that I think we see art in this sense, art and design, if you like, in this kind of a framework. Yeah. How does that bring out?
No, I think, yeah.
See?
Sorry. Renu is there. I think she is unmuted. Renu, do you want to speak?
Yes. Yeah, hello, ma'am. That was a nice activity.
Yeah, go ahead.
In fact, I have never experienced any such activity ever before. Soundscape is something I've never heard of. And I think what I could get from this activity was that the movements, the kind of strokes that we are making depend on the rhythm of the sound that we are hearing. So like we could see, I was doing it with only pencil and that too, not with the lead side, the other side only. So I couldn't actually make out any picture, but seeing the contrast, what two of you had displayed right now, I think one had displayed very fast variation of strokes and the other one was pretty slow. And as, yes ma'am, yours seems little fast while what sir had displayed seemed a little slow movement of strokes. So what I could get was like, one is the variable is the rhythm, the other one is the emotion. Like if we are sad, we tend to do things slowly, so our strokes would also be slow. And if we are enthusiastic, happy, joyful, we tend to do things pretty quickly. So I think that's my take on this, that we can actually help change the emotions of a child while learning by changing the rhythm.
Mm-hmm.
That's what I could get.
To another extreme and say, sometimes when we get angry, we act too quickly. Yeah.
So, yeah, but then the strokes would be different. They may not be that soft, you know. They would be a little deep when we are angry.
So I'm interested in the Navrasas because I think the Navrasas open up a spectrum of emotions. And what's fun in relating the Navrasas, say, to color is the idea that the color also has a spectrum. Yeah, and we can play with the idea of color and emotions. Yes.
I wanted to just say something like she was saying about when we are angry, the strokes might be deeper. Okay. I feel that if I'm angry and I'm drawing this, then actually I'm taking my concentration away from my anger and focusing in here. And it might calm me down rather than, I mean, the it doesn't matter what the strokes are. It will move away from whatever is making me angry to the drawing, perhaps. And that might help me calm down. But for each person, I think the emotion experience might be very different. And how one expresses that emotion also might be very different. So for some person, the flowing strokes might be sad. For other person, the flowing strokes might be something denoting something peaceful. So I was wondering whether one should be interpreting this or just focusing on experiencing this activity itself.
Totally. Thank you for that. Yes. So typically also with our emotions, we are angry, but we're also sometimes, you know, maybe melancholic about something. We are happy about something that we are angry. We are thoughtful about something, you know, why we are angry. So emotions themselves are, you could say, in that way, they have this, this, you could almost look at it in terms of, they have many dimensions. Emotions themselves have many dimensions. And whether we are angry or we are sad or we are happy or joyful, how much are we actually looking at the experiential side of it? And how much are we actually putting a label to what we are calling as a kind of an emotion? Yeah, so I think that's something that would be for the facilitator, more than for the child, for the facilitator to recognize, I feel, that these are not absolute emotions. These are variations. These are, you could say, these are explorations around an emotion. So where and at what point do they become emotions, and where do they retain structure of a shape or a form of a color? Yeah. So at which point do they actually go revert, in sense they kind of retain a certain an understanding of a structure? Yeah. So I'd like to also place that as something that we are. We are seeing in the process. So we are seeing the emotional component in it, the emotional, you could say, quotient in it. And we're also seeing the structural dimension, in the structural, you know, aspect in what we're doing. So just to kind of put the two and two together, how do we see the relationship between, say, for example, if we were to say, let's look at angles, or let's look at, you know, shapes, or let's look at what kind of translation can we have between the shape of a tree and the shape of a river, for example. Yeah, what are the kind of relationships can we build between different living forms, for example. Yeah, so anyway, so I would also like a response to, if we were to go a little bit back before I mentioned about the emotions, and we were to sort of look at the structure of what we were doing, the process, the structure of the process. Yeah, how does that, where did it start from? And what are the kind of tools, in fact, are we taking to develop, you know, what kind of modalities of, you could say, learning and, yeah, essentially a cognition. Can I open that? Are there any kind of questions around that? I see there are lots of questions in the chat. Is there anything that I can take from this?
Chat. Yeah.
So I see, I think this is very subjective. Each child, even adults, will have a unique expression to their emotions. Analyzing the interpreting strokes would make us judgmental in the way.
There is Rashida Kapadia.
Yes.
Rashida Kapadia is saying that soundscape sounds wonderful. Can you please elaborate on how it is connected to teaching and learning?
Yes.
Then should I read others also, or would you like to respond to this?
Yes, could you read a few more, and then because we have a limited time.
Yes, sure. Yeah.
Yes. Yeah, can I, if anybody would like to say something also, you're most welcome.
My app crashed at that moment itself. Hello?
Yeah.
Can you hear me?
Yes.
Yeah, my Zoom crashed just at that moment when I was about to read. So Priya Nair says that both art and dance can help generate emotions as well as a great medium of release.
Yeah.
Then Gini Khatwani, okay, she says that I think this is very subjective. Each child and even adults will have a unique expression to their emotion. Analyzing and interpreting the strokes would make us judgmental in that way. Instead, yeah. As long as the child is expressing and participating in the activity, we are good.
Yeah.
Then Manjari says they hear the sound is made by the person who is also drawing. This is
I think ma'am dropped out. Oh, would you respond to some of the questions, sir?
Yeah. One other, you could use a certain kind of the term soundscape, or we could also call it as a as what we are understanding as sonic. Yeah. So when we're looking at sound as something relating to the way in which we are understanding our interpretation of sound is also different from how we may be hearing sounds that we haven't yet quite been able to interpret it in our own personal ways. And I think that can actually open up a new kind of a query in what we are hearing and what we make out of what we hear. Okay, so there's both the part of sound making that is to do with our own ability to actually create the sound with intention. And there is also the soundscape that we are talking about in terms of, you could call it as a sonic sound, where we are receiving sounds, but we may not yet be responding to those sounds. Yeah, we are still working around the kinds of sounds that we are seeing. So similarly, I would like to bring that element of the visual. So even in the making process of actually doing something visual, we may be in the, we may have the intention of what we are doing, but we also may see that there are things that we do in the image that we've created, which we didn't know about yet. And the act of actually making that image, brings to surface a process of actually questioning ourselves in the act of doing something. What is it that I know in this, and what is it that I didn't know in this? Yeah. Or what is it that I don't know in this? Okay. So that's something that I would also like to. So we speak about sound as though we know what we're talking about. And from the child's point of view, for example, even the language that we are speaking, how much of these words are actually understood, or how much of these words are just, as though they are like sonic sounds. They are sounds that are heard, but not quite understood. Okay. And where do we kind of, where do we bridge the soundscape from being something that we are familiar with to soundscapes that are existing in around us, but yet we don't understand what those sounds actually mean. Okay, so that's something that I would like to put in relation to also visuals, that there are images that we may be presenting, that as an adult, we have acquired a certain way of looking at an image, and therefore we know maybe in a sense what that image represents. But how much of a drawing like this to a child means what we intended? Yeah, what we were trying to articulate. Okay, so how much of this is actually a known, and how much of this is actually an unknown in that sense? Yeah, that's the inquiry that I would like people to kind of question. Yeah.
May I say something? This is Pallavi.
Yes, please.
Sure. Go ahead.
Yeah, I just wanted to add to what you said about not knowing what you're drawing.
Yeah.
This was a new experience for me too, because usually I've drawn for a purpose. Yes. And there's already an end drawing in mind when you start drawing.
Yes.
So I used my pen and my arm as the canvas.
Yes.
So I just started scribbling on my arm.
Yes.
Randomly when I started. I must say I also experienced a bit of boredom after a while. I didn't know how to scribble anymore. So it stumped me that I was constantly trying to look for a form in my scribble, and that I couldn't proceed after a while.
Yeah.
It's interesting. I could just relate it to how little kids, toddlers especially, scribble endlessly without looking specifically for a form.
Yeah.
So, yeah, I just wanted to describe my experience.
Yes, thanks for that. Yeah. Would anybody respond to this? This thought about how children also spend hours, for example. I myself, I remember as a child, would just kind of, just beat something for hours. And it was only much later that I started seeing that there was a certain structure to what I was doing. It was, maybe when I was around 10 years old that I actually saw myself as becoming, a drummer, for example. And until then, it was just a, maybe even a nuisance that I was creating.
I'd like to share something. Actually, there was a child in my class previously. So he used to have a lot of temper tantrums, and he had a little problem in the pincer grip. So we used to give him a paper and crayons. So he used to scribble on the crayons. On the paper. And whenever he used to have a bad morning, in the morning when he used to have a bad morning, he must have woken up late, or mother must have shouted or something, that day he used to use black color, blue color and such colors, and he used to scribble badly on the paper so that it tears.
Hello. I think we lost her, but you can respond. Okay.
Yeah.
The connection came back.
Yeah. So, we had seen a change in that child, with the crayons and the scribbling. So that was my experience of a child doing the scribbling with some crayons, and I don't know, with his mood, maybe.
So what would you see the transformation? Where do you see the transformation actually happening?
Talking to him, or maybe transitioning from he was the only child in the house, and the parents had a late delivery. So he was a child who must have had a lot of pampering at home and stuff like that. But then he was a kind of a special child also. So whatever was going on in his mind, he wanted to speak it out. And he may not have had people to, talk to, or not understand his feelings or something. So he came and he used to initially he did not respond well, but then later when we started talking to him in his way and all, so he started responding to us. So that was the change that came about in him.
Would you see a person, I don't know what the age would be of this child, but would you see maybe at when the child becomes a teenager, for example, that there is some recall of how the process of actually being able to draw something or being able to play, maybe an instrument, or being able to actually do sports, for example, or in fact actually enter into a laboratory and test out chemicals, for example.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So where do you see that element of playfulness extends? That would be the kind of...
Yeah.
Roshan, Roshan just wanted to remind you, we are at 3.
Yes.
456.
Yeah. So what I would like to pose in this framework is the extensions of what we are actually talking about in terms of a simple process, which we kind of started off with, and then how does that broaden our kind of our ability to see ourselves playing in with numbers, to see ourselves playing with chemicals, to see us playing with the kind of technology that we have. You find a lot of youth actually very able to use technology in the way that I have absolutely no clue, what those kind of apps can do. And in fact, there's an element of playfulness in there too. And what is that? What is that shift that maybe we are seeing from tools that we were using of a certain within a certain kind of a developmental mode, and what how do we see those as extensions to a development in terms of the child's ability to actually relate to things happening outside in the world? That's the kind of broad I would say that's the kind of broad field of kind of a study that one's kind of looking into, which we're saying that, okay, there are simple forms, there are simple processes used in multiple ways, frameworks as facilitators of our, teaching, modalities. Yeah, and underlying this, I am also hoping that we are seeing that the element of rhythm has a part in this whole process. And I would be, if anybody would like to say something about the rhythm aspect, did you see that the rhythm was anything to do with what we did, or is the rhythm something which is not contextual to the process? Yeah. Okay. Can I get a quick response from that, please? What is the rhythm element in this?
I think there was a rhythm element. Yeah. If anybody would like to unmute, because I certainly did feel it, and I have experienced that in my drawing also. And if people can share their viewpoint, it would be.
Yeah, so people are talking about therapy, which I we're definitely kind of using therapy in a broader sense. For example, are we talking about therapy from an aesthetic, understanding, or are we talking about therapy from a more structural, I would say, like biological, way of thinking about what we are doing, besides it being art as a, as a cultural kind of a thought in terms of, the aesthetics around what we do every day. How are these kind of therapies, in a sense, biological? How are they actually the part of our very, makeup, which need not necessarily be cultural. It is something which is, it is something innate. It is something instinctive also. Yeah, so movement, for example, is something innate, I would say. And it comes about in different forms. And similarly, maybe mark making, you could say, is kind of an innate process. Any thoughts about rhythm? Anybody would like to say something about rhythm? I'm curious because I see myself using rhythm as a provocation. And I'm interested in what actually people see in rhythm and how do they see facilitation as rhythmic, if you like. Yeah. So everybody is keeping very quiet. Quiet also has a rhythm. I always love that fact. Silence has a rhythm. So that's also nice.
Chitra, would you like to? Yeah, Ram, go ahead. Ram.
So I was just trying to figure out what you mean by rhythm. And I see that it's not so easy to put it into words. When I put my pencil to the paper, it's not so tough. When I put the color to the paper, it can flow smoothly. Whatever lines or curves come, it's okay. There's no judgment on it. But if I have to describe that, it's quite tough. But yes. It feels good when I do that. I enjoy seeing repetitive strokes or curved lines, sharp edges, shading. Yeah. So there seems to be a rhythm, but I am unable to articulate it or describe it. So
nice.
Only thing is I can
say. I like the use of your word repetition. Yeah. So we have recall. And then we retain a certain maybe recall, and we're also the ability to actually repeat becomes you could say then has that element of cyclical also learning, which I would almost say extends into other domains. Yeah. So how do you take a simple process and then recall it, retain it, and repeat it? And that becomes something which then, enters into a certain kind of a cyclical mode, which then extends into sort of other transferable, modalities that, you can play with as far as, the repetition goes. Repetition is a key kind of a component in what we're also understanding as learning.
Thank you so much.
Yeah, thanks so much for that. So how do you repeat also something that without becoming mechanical, and how do you see the rhythm of that? How do you see the flow of a form that is repeatable? Yeah, and it need not necessarily be forced. It is something that can actually come because of a certain kind of a movement, because of a certain kind of a joy in what we are doing. Yeah, so the rhythm is to be rhythmic is also to be joyful.
Sure. Any other questions? Does anybody wants to ask a question? Or Roshan, any last thoughts?
Yes, I'm very interested in Also, if I do have access to the feedback, I'll be really, it'll be helpful for me also, because I feel that we are struggling with the problems of, for example, this exactly this term of repetition, because we see that it is mechanical, but it is an essential component to all learning habits, if you like. And that ability to actually recall, retain, and repeat is something that we are struggling with just now, because we kind of feel that we want to become more creative, we want to do, you know, fun things. But how do we actually, in a way, also constructively use it in a kind of an instructional mode as well as in a experiential mode, in the way that we're connecting to the world around us? So we are, I feel that's, it's a time when we are also trying to use old tricks, if you like, in more, you know, sort of, in fun ways, like in contemporary kind of, you know, current, in the kind of thought that we have in the current sort of, you know, educational kind of pedagogic philosophy, we are trying to say, hey, let's like not get stuck with the rote learning, for example, or let's not get stuck with a certain kind of a mechanical way of learning. Let's see it being creative. And then having creativity, now what do we do? Like, you know, where do we start? Where do we kind of structure it? Where do we see it within a framework? And that's really a challenge, because it's like, how do we get freedom with no boundaries? You know, how do we kind of, how do we frame freedom, if you like? Yeah, or how do we frame creativity? So that's where I'm kind of, that's where my heart beats, if you like. Yeah, so that's I think I shall.
May I say something here? Yes. I'm sorry to like jump in right at the end, but it's very interesting. I think this retain, recall, and repeat can also be done when we have a certain story weaved along with that.
100%.
So, you know, when I teach history to my eighth grader, it's absolutely the opposite way, the way his history teacher has taught him. And he hates history, as in he hated history. But I got this big teacher's pad and drew a mind map of, you know, we started from the story of how this was killed and how this happened. So suddenly that story sat in his head, and he doesn't even need to go to the, you know, resource or the notebook or book. You just talk about one point.
That's right.
He remembers that day because of his sister's birthday. It was like before this, before, after that. Yes. So all you need to do is that hint, and then the entire thing comes. And sometimes, of course, I understand that children cannot make the right stories because they would not be able to include all the components needed. Mm-hmm. But the teacher can help them first, then after that, and finally. If we give them those kind of prompts, I think it will not be rote learning, but they will be able to make connections, unless and until they make connections and, you know, put themselves in that story or a mathematical, like a problem or whatever it is. Tab tak wo log, they cannot be part of that. And somehow we've alienated, you know, book ke problems, teacher ka homework, mummy papa ke liye grades. We've alienated, and the child feels, who am I? You guys are like torturing me.
What's the pattern? It's like, you know, where's it all coming from? Yes.
Well, I would say parents are very pushy.
That's also, so what is that? Yeah, I love the fact that you are bringing in these elements of both the instruction part and the connectedness to the world around us. You know, whether it's social connect, whether it's the environment, the natural world, whether it's actually technology, what are the connects that we're actually making with the you could say the kind of model that we have in terms of, you know, learning or, you know, education, as you know, what we're calling as a kind of a an instructional, you know, sort of a mode. So where do we kind of bridge these, or where do we create these networks I love the fact that you could also say, you know, that it need not necessarily be about a picture. It could be about a story. It could be about an event.
Yeah.
And there's a recall in that, and there's a repeat in that, to the point where it can become more and more imaginative in the way that it can actually reimagine the situation.
Yeah.
It becomes an embodied story. It's not a story that you hear of. It's actually a story that you have made as a part of your own way of thinking and understanding the world around you.
Yeah. And I think it helps them, you know, break down the complex things as they go further.
Yes.
It can be applied in chemistry and, you know, in something else. Just break it down into simpler components and relate it to your real life.
Exactly. Yeah. Thank you.
Yes. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much.
Are there any other more questions?
Yeah, namaste to all. This is Jagdish from Agastya International Foundation.
Yes.
We are closely moving to the government school children.
Yes.
We are struggling to teach some tables. Only the way is the magab. Is there any musical way to teach the mathematical tables? Please. Thank you.
Yes, we have. If that is a question, I've definitely explored this. And we've definitely worked with both dance forms as well as musical forms. I think the relationship between what you see in terms of numbers as not only being abstract ideas, but actually as being you could say in that sense, experienced, you know, say, for example, if you have, again, like, you know, two people with a single house, you're actually putting the numbers in reality, you're putting the numbers in shape, and they're not abstract ideas. So when you're saying that there are two people and there are two people, and how many do these add up to, I think there is a transference of looking at numbers as purely a sign to understanding how that number is relating to a real life situation. And it's a tough one, because the more and more complex you get in, for example, mathematics, the more abstract it becomes. And then again, the whole problem of actually how does this relate to real life situations, for example. So the connectedness about, or the what we're calling as the embodiedness of, you know, say a subject like mathematics. My view is art can actually come in there. It can take on that role of allowing the person to become imaginative and to see relationships that may not have otherwise been obvious, that were, you know, it could have been, I have like a classic one of the idea that you can have, you know, a cube, you may have heard of this, with the cube 10 centimeters by 10 centimeters, that's the kind of size, with spheres that are 20 centimeters by 20 centimeters. How do you fit a sphere into a cube, which is 10 centimeters by 10 centimeters? Yeah, so now, where do you put that in reality? Where do you kind of understand that maybe the spheres are ideas and the cubes are also ideas? And the relationship between a sphere entering into a cube, which is, you know, smaller than that of a cube, needs an imaginative process to actually be able to solve that problem. Sort of like play on how the reality then can actually be, can itself be questioned. Yeah, what we thought as being real, what we thought as being visible, what we thought as being tangible, suddenly becomes, you know, an idea of something. It becomes a way of looking at something. It becomes, you know, a reality that we had never imagined it to be a reality. Yeah, So I see that art and, you know, the what we're calling as creativity can play into these otherwise very sort of hard and fast rules about, you know, what are numbers, for example, or what are what is multiplication? Yeah. Anyway, I'm interested in how we can become more imaginative in learning. How do we in the way that we're talking about in terms of pedagogy? What is that component of the imagination that plays into our understanding of reality? Yeah, so that's something that I'm really curious about, and I'm constantly surprised about the reality itself. You know, how many times are we actually talking about imaginary things and understanding that that is really, you know, the basis of our notions of what is real? Yeah. I hope that kind of little bit answers your question.
Thank you, sir.
Thanks. Yes. Thanks. Yeah.
So multiplication is a fantastic thing. Richard Feynman, he really talks about how he learns multiplication. So he's a great example of being a super creative person and being, you know, highly mathematical, highly calculative, highly... you could almost say you could say that his ability to actually to realize things was using his ability to imagine. Yeah, it was using his imaginative powers to understand the real. And I love the fact that actually he could do that. So Richard Feynman is a great example of understanding multiplication sums. Great. I think rhythmic tasks are of more importance. Yes. So I think we may have crossed our time, but
we'll like conclude now. So thank you, Roshan sir. This last 1 hour has been very enlightening journey for all of us. We have got to learn a lot of new things, especially the blending of rhythm, music, painting, all of that. Yes. And in the end, I would like to reiterate our deepest gratitude from this Center of Excellence in Teacher Education and Tata Institute of Social Science, Mumbai, to you and for having graced us with your presence this afternoon. I would also like to thank the faculty and all our attendees for being here with us till now. I would like to thank all of you once again. And before you leave, please fill the feedback form. Thank you.
Thank you so much. Thanks so much.
Yeah, and I'll stay for a while. Please fill the feedback form. And if you have anything, you can, share any doubts.
Yeah.
Thank you, everyone. Sarah.
Yeah, so Chitra has also shared the feedback form in the chat and also the Telegram group link. If anyone wants to join the Telegram group and continue the discussion there, they can do that. And please do fill up the feedback form. It is very important for us to get that feedback form. And we will continue the discussion on the Telegram group.
Thank you. Thanks a lot.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you so much, Roshan, for this very interesting session. These are the aspects that are very important and needs to be focused about in art education. In fact, I would say in today's time, it is much more important than anything other academic that we are doing. And we as adults need this. So thanks a lot for sharing your thoughts here with all of us.
Thank you so much. Yeah, I'll be leaving now.
Sure. Thank you, sir. Thank you, ma'am.
Bye-bye. Thank you.
Thank you. Bye.
Thank you, ma'am.
Bye. So we are just hanging on here for a few minutes in case anybody has problem with the feedback form filling. If you have filled up the feedback form, please, you can log out.
You decide. Akka decide.
Thank you, ma'am.
Okay, ma'am. Thank you. Thank you so much.
Thank you, teachers. See you in the next session. Certificates we will be getting only after a certain number of workshops we have completed. So it will come not now, but in the later sessions. We will be informing you about that. Thank you.
Hello.
Yes.
Yeah. Hi, Ruchi, Namrata here again.
Yeah. Hi, Namrata. Go ahead. I can hear you.
Yeah. Actually, you know, that time, you know, though I joined the session, but actually, you know, I'm a part of a team. We are like with the NEP and progress and, you know, implementation. We were looking for these training sessions and everything. And, you know, we, in our school is a very like reputed one, but we were looking for certain institutions which we could share for, apart from CBSE, British Council, and places where we get. So this actually happened to me during lockdown when I joined the program. But I want to know more about the CETE.
Okay.
Because I'm going to pitch, you know, the institutions that we can connect with for the teacher training programs. Either customize or your
Okay. So I'm on the private chat. I'm giving you my number. We can talk in the evening. I have to go to another meeting right now. So I will talk to you in the evening. Sure. I'm sending, I'm Namrata. Okay. Found. Just wait. I'm sending my number on chat. Okay. Did you get it, Namrata? Hello, Namrata. Did you get my number?
Hello, yes, Namrata. I did. Sorry. Yeah, Ruchi, okay. I did. I was on.
Bye then.
Yeah, bye. Thank you.
Stop the recording.
Yeah, sure. We.